Lagos has always been an important commercial hub in Nigeria and, in fact, in Africa. The state is moving from a mega city to a smart city. And that is why I'm here to keep you up to speed on how the state is developing day by day. I'm Adedoja Salamadeni, and you're watching Inside Lagos.
Today on Inside Lagos, Governor Akinwumi Ambode, together with the Federal Ministry of Information, Culture and Tourism, plan to restructure the National Museum. Lagos State Government to establish a state-owned DNA forensic laboratory. These are more stories when we return. Please stay with us.
Lagos State Governor Akinwumi Ambode received the Minister of Information, Culture and Tourism, Alhaji Lai Mohammed, on a courtesy visit last Thursday at the Lagos House, Ikeja. During the visit, Governor Ambode vowed to transform the National Museum in Lagos to a modern-day cultural edifice.
And then we have Dr.
Lai Mohammed said he was in Lagos to solicit the support of the Lagos State Government in developing culture and tourism. He wants a facelift for federal infrastructure in the state, including the National Theatre and the National Museum.
This government is not going to sell the National Theatre to anybody. We're only concessioning the fallow areas around the National Theatre so that it can be turned into an entertainment city. Of course, again, there's the National Museum. Whatever assistance we can receive from Lagos State, again, even in upgrading the facilities and the, probably completely restructuring and giving it a facelift.
Governor Ambode said he was willing to collaborate with the federal government to ensure the speedy completion of the project, which he said would enhance the cultural heritage of Nigeria.
We'll do it because it's eventually to the benefit of Lagosians and eventually to the growth of the economy of Lagos. So we'll be looking in the area of the museum that is in at Onikan to see how we can put up a modern day museum of international standard in that place and to see how that can work towards our Lagos at 50 celebration next year.
During an interview with State House correspondents, the minister spoke on why the Buhari administration was presently focusing on the war against corruption.
Corruption is eating deep, not just in the fabric of our morals, but is preventing development. We lose 40% infants before they are 5 years old is because of lack of medical care, and that's simply because of corruption. Why we are in darkness in most parts of India today is because of corruption. So this is the emphasis of government. We are not out to witch hunt anybody.
It was a homecoming for Lai Mohammed, having worked here as a chief of staff to former Governor Bola Tinubu in 1999. As the minister left the State House, Inside Lagos joined its convoy to the National Museum located at Onikan area of the state. On arrival, officials of the museum gave him a warm welcome. Lai Mohammed is here to see the state of the museum himself. The museum curator, Edith Ekunke, took the minister, Lagos Commissioner for Information, and his tourism counterpart around the facility. The environment was typically unkempt, and the old place appeared totally abandoned. Yet, pupils would not stop coming for excursion. There was no power supply. Students have found reading at the library in the dark. This museum also houses the bullet-riddled car in which the country's former head of state, the late General Muritala Muhammad, was assassinated in 1976.
We are coming to visit the museum. Yes, sir. Yeah, there must be a conducive environment. Don't be flicking, you are going to leave it. No, you can't. So what can I look at? This week? Or what?
The inspection ends here, and it was time to go. Now, the minister and the Lagos commissioners are fully aware of the state of the museum and now have an idea of how much work to be done here.
The Lagos state government has offered to help us rebuild this national museum, and that we are taking the offer with not only two hands, with all our body. And we've come here today too, and we've seen that, yes, the National Museum is indeed in need of, you know, not just a facelift, but a completely new structure. And this is just a preliminary visit. We'll come back and work with the Lagos State Government on the design, on the location. Here, both the DG of the National Council for Museums and Monuments and the management of the National Museum Onikan and Lagos and Ministry of, we all work together to ensure that this project is completed within a very short period, at least before May 2017.
What the Lagos State Government is trying to do, based on the request from the Honorable Minister for Information, Culture and Tourism, is to acknowledge that, yes, it's a federal property, but it is in Lagos. It caters to the need of Lagosians. You can see the pupils and students, you know, that come here on excursion almost on a daily basis. 400, 500, 600 of them on a daily basis, they're Lagosians. They are Lagos people. So it is in our own interest, it is in the interest of citizens of Lagos State, that a place like the National Museum, and national in code, but Lagos in terms of land and residency, it is to our own interest that this place upgrades, this place, lives up to the billing of its name, so that it can be at par with other museums that we see all over the world. So Lagos will invest in it because it is here, it is in Lagos State.
The National Museum was established in 1957. It has great collections in archaeology, ethnography, and traditional art. This museum displays contemporary arts and historical monuments. If both the federal and the Lagos State governments fix this, it will not just serve as a learning point for students, but a tourist center.
We need a modern 21st century museum. We need a place where there's e-learning, there's sound studio, there's music studio, there's a place where children can come and read, where the art of Nigeria, the heritage and culture of our people, can stand proud and be exhibited. Not in dark, moldy rooms, in air-conditioned rooms, climate control, temperature control, where you can say, yes, this is a painting that was made, drawn by Ben Nwowu. This is a place where we can go and ask art collectors who have billions of naira in works of art, sitting down without space to exhibit them, to say, let us take your art away. It's insured. We understand the value. And showcase it in a place that when they come in here, they will be happy to see themselves.
Cultural tourism is a growing aspect of tourism which attracts millions of people to throng to some countries to observe their cultural facilities, including museums. Now that the Lagos State government is set to upgrade the National Museum, Nigerians hope to have an international standard museum before May 2017.
Lagos State government, in furtherance of its commitment to the criminal justice reform, is set to establish a state-owned DNA forensic laboratory. The State Commissioner for Justice, Adeniji Kazim, at a press briefing at Alausa, said his ministry would drive this initiative.
The role of the DNA in forensics, law enforcement and the justice sector is well known globally, but no standard DNA analysis center is available in Nigeria. Lagos State government, as a pacesetter, is again taking the bull by its horn. The Lagos State DNA Forensics Center will ensure DNA profiling of international standard. The laboratory is said to be a unique solution to fighting crime in the desire for a safer and secure Lagos.
DNA can be used to identify criminals with incredible accuracy when biological evidence exists. The center will assist in collection and preservation of evidential DNA, which can later be used in decoding familial relationships of individuals in paternity cases. In event of a disaster where bodies are unidentifiable, the process of identifying them and bringing closure to the families become faster and easier. The Lagos State Ministry of Justice, with the active support of His Excellency Governor Akinwumi Ambode, will drive this initiative vigorously.
In case of rape and other violent sexual acts, this forensic laboratory can make or mar the outcome.
In a rape case, biological evidence obtained from the victim, analyzed and compared with the suspect, can either indict or exonerate the alleged perpetrator of the offense. It reduces the incidences of false allegations.
Cases of rape and defilement, the victim cannot come to court, or maybe the victim is a small child that cannot really express themselves. Because of the lack of DNA, it is very, very difficult at times for even the victims to get justice. Getting justice on one side, and then of course the perpetrator as well would be prosecuted, and then it will serve as deterrent for other would-be perpetrators.
Kazim vowed that the Lagos State DNA Forensic Center will be ready between 6 to 12 months. Meanwhile, the Domestic and Sexual Violence Response Team of the Lagos State Ministry of Justice has launched the Lagos State Sexual Assault Standing Order and Rape Kits.
Something guiding this case, or what?
Is there a law?
No. This order?
Yes. This is a Lagos State Sexual Assault Standing Order for health workers that manage sexual assault cases.
Does it have to do with these kits?
Yes, because it's based on this basically enlightens the user of the kits.
Okay.
So it's not just to have the kit, you have to know how to use the kit. You have to know the different stages. You have to know which examination to do, the process, the protocol that must be followed. That's what this is.
And it will be given to all the primary health care in Lagos State. And we have over 200 primary health care in Lagos State.
So what we did was to identify 5 pilot PhDs, and we did the selection scientifically. So we looked at the statistics. Where are these issues most prevalent in? And based on our statistics, we found 5 primary health care centers: Koshofe, Ikorodu, Ifakojai, Oshodi, Solo, and Mushi. And that is why we are using those 5 PhDs as our pilot. That's where these kits will be, that's where these forms will be, that's where the standing order will be. We'll watch it, and hopefully it will extend across all PhDs.
The launch took place at the training for health workers at the Lagos Office of the Public Defender. That development is with a view to increasing victim safety and offender responsibility by providing a holistic response that is uniform in approach on sexual and gender-based violence cases across Lagos State.
The introduction of the rape kit and the standing order is to assist and allow the doctors and nurses that will be attending to victims of any form of sexual offences to collate evidence when they examine the victim, and also to preserve evidence for the purposes of going for DNA and any form of test in the lab, and also for the purposes of prosecuting the cases as well.
The Lagos State Sexual Assault Standing Order for healthcare workers, for doctors and nurses that attend to patients who are victims of rape, defilement, and sexual assault by penetration. It basically enumerates the different steps that should be taken when a patient presents him or herself to the primary health care center. For instance, the first step is to take the patient to a designated room, offer counseling, psychosocial support, conduct the necessary examination.
Still ahead, State Commissioner for Transportation Dayo Mobiriola updates Inside Lagos on the issue of BRT ticketers and ticketing. Inside Lagos, we'll be right back. Lagos, the economic capital of West Africa, with a population of more than 20 million people, a lot of things happen here, but not all are well reported. From the island to the mainland, from the government house to your street, Inside Lagos brings you Lagos news in the most informative and entertaining way. I'm Adedoja Salam Adeniyi. I live in Lagos, and this is Inside Lagos.
Lagos State Commissioner for Transportation, Dayo Mobirola, was on this show, and there was issue of ticketing and ticketers. So I am here at Ikorodu bus stop now to know whether the issue of ticketers and ticketing has been resolved by the Lagos State Ministry of Transportation. Please come with me. I'd like to interview some of the passengers of the new BRT now. The issue of ticketers and ticketing has been resolved now because there was a problem
Well, this is the first time I'm boarding it from this station.
Okay, how do you see that service?
Well, the service is okay because there's no much crowd and I think you can get the ticket and everything is okay.
So the service is better now?
Better.
Okay.
Better.
That is a helpful sir.
God bless you.
How will you show the ticket and ticket is okay?
They're very effective and efficient. There's no problem. And they enjoy their service.
Under
our loan, go and wow, okay.
I think their service is okay, you know, it's actually it's a bit comfort, you know, to compare to any other public transport. Yeah, it's more easier now. So, you know, they are trying. I want them to improve, you know, at least to give us more buses so as to make the journey more easier. Thank you.
Okay, I would still like to speak more with the passengers. Sir, are you a passenger, sir? Can you talk to us, please? Thank you. Thank you. What's your name, sir?
My name is Benjamin. Mr. Benjamin.
Okay. How long have you been flying this road, Ikorodu to CMS, something with the new BRT?
It's about 2 months now.
Okay. So how would you say their service is now?
It's okay. It's fine.
How do you get some ticket? Do you get it on time?
Sometimes we crowd to get tickets, sometimes we, as we can see, we are not crowding today. But some days we come, we have a large crowd, so we play with them to have some more staffs.
Because there was a time people were stranded here, I want to know whether that has been resolved.
Let me say yes, for now. So we thank them for at least making it a bit okay for us, but they should make it more better than this. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
To be honest, it's easier. Like, for example, I came here 3 minutes ago and I was easily able to get my ticket. But I think it could be better if maybe people could buy with the ATM because there's a problem of the people selling tickets not having change and things like that. And I just think it would be better if people could use maybe their cards and just as a suggestion. But it's by far better, to be honest.
There's improvement. Exactly. That as at last 2-3 weeks, there was no ticket on the ground. But right now there are tickets out. As you can see, I've bought my ticket. We are waiting for bus now. It's improving. It's improving. Yeah, I want them, what we need more bus. I need them to keep it up. We are enjoying the services. At least from here to mainland, my body will be cooling. We are enjoying the services, okay.
Let the ticket be available on time or before. If I have my ticket yesterday, if the bus is available there, we board without rushing.
The drivers have to become, they have to resume early, one, then two. The availability, they have to make the bus available on time. And the three, the machine, the card machine, is not always working. You understand? Then, finally, the ticket. That's all.
It's need also for the Lamata authorities to sensitize passengers on the usage of the buses. When they are inside, there are some seats reserved for the physically challenged. When you see an able person sitting on it, and here you have a physically challenged person coming in, they don't usually get up, and I have witnessed one resulting into conflict. So there is need for them to ask the drivers to always sensitize passengers before, you know, commencing their trips. Also, the yellow seats, usually for the elderly, where I have seen. But when you see a younger person, you know, sitting down, and an elder, a senior citizen standing up, I think it's right for the little child to get up for the senior citizen to sit. So there is need for them to do that sensitization and awareness to promote peace within the bus. And it will reduce conflict since they know it's coming from the authorities. People are likely to align and obey immediately.
We took these concerns to the man whose office is directly responsible for BRT operations in Lagos State. He is Dayo Mobiriola, the State Commissioner for Transport. Inside Lagos recently took him up on ticketing and other related issues. It's time to check with him what has changed between then and now.
Well, you remember that the last time you interviewed me,
there were a lot of complaints that there were buses, there were passengers, but the ticketing system were not working.
The only minor problem we have is the ticketing machine in my head. This afternoon, as I was about to walk, the machines were not working.
The ticketer is not always available. And when there is ticket, the buses are not there.
So what we have done is to improve upon it by increasing the numbers of stations where people can buy tickets even before they get to the terminals, and also to bring in new equipment, because part of the problem then was that the POS, that's the machine which generates the ticket or validates it, the battery runs down very quickly. So we have improved upon that as well. And we have also spread the location so that not everybody gravitates to one position to buy tickets and then get onto the bus. So we have responded very well, and we are sure that the issue as we address it has not been totally resolved, but 98, 95, we're almost there. We have learned from our mistake of the past, and then we have improved upon it, as you can see, whereby a lot of people are not complaining about it anymore. But the good thing is we are not going to stop where we are. We are going to continue to improve on it, bringing new technology, new software, to make sure that the ticketing system becomes more responsive to the needs of the people as we see it need. What we take, for example, the numbers of people that were actually entering the buses at Korodu, we were estimating that there would be about 8,000 people in the morning. But by the time we started the scheme, there were actually about 19,000, 20,000 people taking the bus. So it means that the provision of the ticketing system was not adequate enough to address the needs. And then as intensity of the use as well made the battery to run down. So that's one of the major problems. The governor said we should look at a ticketing system that will be a total ticketing system, meaning that you'll be able to use it on the BRT, on the lag bus, on the ferry, for your trading, for anything you want to do. It will be just one ticket type of platform. And that is the new innovation, which His Excellency alluded to. And that is the improvement that we are going to bring on board, so that it will be just one ticket every transaction you want to do, whether you want to pay for your taxis, whether you want to buy things in the shop, whether you want to enter the buses, or whether you want to enter a ferry, rail, any mode of transaction. It will just be one platform ticket. Sometimes challenges turn out to be good for the masses and for everybody, for the operator, for regulators, and then for the passengers. So yes, it's something that we would not have liked to have happened, but for the fact that it has happened, it has made us to improve upon it and to give the people a better way of doing things, a better ticketing system, and has actually given us an idea of making it even a lot better. So the new one that we are going to launch is going to be 100% better than what they are using at the moment.
The Lagos State Traffic Management Authority last month, in conjunction with Deeper Life Bible Church, organized an awareness program to sensitize residents of Oduwaye Street at Bagada on the expected traffic in the area. This is due to the construction of a flyover bridge in the area by the church.
This is the headquarters of the Deeper Life Bible Church. It is located at Bagada area of the state. This gigantic structure is fully ready, but it will not be commissioned until a flyover bridge and a car park that will contain about 1,000 vehicles are constructed. The bridge, when completed, is expected to ease both human and vehicular traffic on this axis. These are residents of the area. They gathered here for a sensitization and awareness program on how best to manage traffic on this axis pending the construction of the bridge. No doubt, it will be a major challenge.
We have mapped out alternative routes for residents because this old way will be totally closed for traffic. So all other network of roads will be used. And our men, we are going to partner with them. Our men will be in position to control and manage traffic within the period or within the duration of the construction that it will last. The agency is going to partner with them so as to reduce the hardship that people will suffer in this area as a result of the construction. The duration is 10 months. According to their plan, it's 10 months, but it could be less.
This architect is the member of the church, is in charge of the project. He says the construction of the bridge will take 10 months to be completed, and they had to partner with LASMA to ensure traffic flow within that period.
We believe that the Lord helping us, this will really beautify the whole community and also ease the trouble of traffic. Because when you look at the human traffic, it's even more than the vehicular traffic. If we're able to take care of the human traffic, then the normal traffic, the normal vehicular traffic will continue and all that. We had to contact the Minister of Transportation, the Lagos State, to partner with them, you know, to make sure that even while construction is going on, you know, the traffic here is well controlled. And that's why we have the LASMA officials here from the Minister of Transportation, and we have been working together to make sure that things really go well.
And that does it on today's edition of Inside Lagos. Many thanks for being there. But before we meet next time, please don't forget to reach us on our platforms showing on your screen. My name is Adedoja Salama Deni. See you next time. Bye-bye.